raised up on mountain, be made low.
Where do you go from that?
Wow. Listen, adults, if we're going to sit in our pants in our seat, these young kids are going to make it happen. This is a war cry of our youth. We're in good hands. I'm pumped up. This is exciting. Well, welcome again. I'm Angel Barnett. We have a few fun, exciting verbals that are coming up we want you to know about in December. Celebration of Christmas. This place is going to be packed every single night. We don't want you guys to miss out. There should be some information on the screen. Please get your tickets. They are going faster than they did last year, so don't miss out. It's a gift to the state of Arizona. It's beloved for over 42 years, so please come be a part of that. A brand new series launching, I think it launched last week, but Luke will be back this Sunday, Revolutionary Church. We can be relevant and talk about the issues of the day, but that's only being relevant. Are we revolutionary? That's doing something. That's like what those kids just expressed tonight. They're doing something, not talking about it. So come out on Sunday. If you don't have a church home, we'd love to be your home. Okay, there is no Freedom Night in America in December because of the Christmas show and everything going on, but we have Ben Carson with us on December 11th. That's on a Sunday, so we would love to have you guys come out and be with us. Really incredible things are happening, and we're honored to have him. Ushers, if you would come forward. You know, 2 years ago, a crazy accident happened, and my husband's not here tonight. And 2 years ago, he was on the Arizona Trail with my daughter, and an incredible attack, I believe, of the enemy came upon him as he was trying to raise money for hurting people in Colorado City. But instead of me talking about it, we have a video for you, just to refresh.
A hike for a good cause almost turned deadly for a Phoenix father and daughter.
Yeah, Max Gordon shares their harrowing ordeal and the unexpected ending.
It started as an 800-mile hike along the Arizona Trail. Luke Barnett and his daughter Anna Lee were raising money for the Colorado City Dream Center, which helps victims of polygamy and human trafficking run out of the former compound of the infamous polygamist Warren Jeffs.
It's very important to us because we believe that every single human life matters to God, and those people, they matter to God up there, and they ought to matter to us as well.
What are we looking at, Dad?
The hike started on September 27th, and things were going well. But 500 miles in, trouble on the trail.
They're estimated this boulder was about 8,000 to 10,000 pounds.
As they scrambled into a wash, the two dislodged a boulder, and Pastor Luke pushed his daughter away right before it fell on him.
Broke my forearm. It broke three of my ribs. It broke my femur. And my hip.
How are you doing, Dad?
I'm doing good.
Anna Lee used her first aid skills to stabilize her dad and called in rescuers using a satellite phone.
Thank you, God.
And I remember saying to her before the chopper picked me up, this hike has to go on.
And it has. Anna Lee is scheduled to finish the hike this Saturday, raising hundreds of thousands of dollars for women in need in the process.
Not only is she strong as an individual, but she understands that the cause really is bigger than us.
Max Gordon, Arizona's family.
Hey guys, here we are, Adventure Your Life 2.0. We began this journey back in October of 2020, right in the middle of all the COVID madness, and had a unfortunate accident 500 miles in. Boulder broke my femur, my hip, my forearm, three ribs, my almost lost a finger and the whole thing, but it's 2 years later now, and we are not quitters. We are gonna finish this thing. We have 300 more miles until we complete the famous Arizona Trail. And we're doing this to, of course, raise money to help a town out, Colorado City, where we have a dream center. And I'm so proud of the people of Colorado City. Man, you guys are amazing troopers, man. You're survivors. You're doing great things. You're recovering your city. We're so proud of you. And We just want to help you and partner with you. I got some friends who are helping me on this trail. Come on over here, guys. I got Josh Ursu, the Romanian nightmare. And I got Andy Scheip as well. These guys have been so amazing to help me out and recover me with my legs cramp and help me finish this thing. So we are really excited. We're excited to see what's going to happen up in Colorado City. And we're at the border of Mexico right now. You can see all these containers over here that they're putting in line to form the border wall. And so it's kind of cool that our border is getting all secured up. But here we are. We have 300 miles to go, and today is the big start. Bless you guys. I'm so proud of you, Colorado City. Keep going strong.
So proud of him. We wanted to share that with you tonight because he's out there right now. He's got 22 miles tomorrow and he's getting sore as he goes. So you know what? He knows that you are all here. You're behind him. We're going to pray over this offering and let's just let it compound his efforts as the community of Colorado City, Short Creek, has rebounded. You know, what the government tried to go in and do. Just loving kindness of the church, being consistent with no strings attached, is making a huge impact. So we want to lead the way, be the tip of the spear. Let me pray over this offering. Lord, we thank you that you would just compound this offering, that you would bless the giver and bless their families, their relationships, their unanswered prayers, their businesses. Lord, thank you that we get to be a part of something that's bigger than ourselves. This is what life is all about. We thank you for this opportunity to be able to give. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you. Thank you so much for making a difference in Arizona. We have a few more upcoming events. We have those on video for you.
Dream City Church, Arizona. Sean Foyt here. Man, I love you guys so much. I wish I could be in person to share this special announcement. However, I couldn't make it work this time, but I want to let you know this is historic, what you're about to see. We are joining forces with TPUSA Faith, and we are launching one of the most crazy, wild, God-ordained tours in American history. We are bringing the kingdom to the Capitol, all 50 states, all 50 state capitals. We're showing up. We're bringing worship. We're bringing prayer. We're bringing activism. We're calling for a bold church to rise to meet the crazy hour that we live in, and we want you guys to be a part of it. We put together this special promotional video for you to check out. I pray that it lights your heart on fire and that you join with us as we bring the kingdom to the Capitol all across America in 2023 and 2024. You can go to kingdomtothecapitol.com to sign up to be a part. Watch this video. Let your heart be set on fire. Good things are coming, baby. Let's go.
I love when he moves and people say he can't move. Do it tonight, oh God, over this city.
What started with a remnant, small Gideon's army on the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco in July of 2020 has now gone viral across America. We have taken Let Us Worship to over 170 cities across the nation, gathered hundreds of thousands, seen tens of thousands saved, healed, delivered, set free, and the heart of the nation awaken again. This is the season to dream even bigger with God as we take the momentum of what He's done the last 2 years and we bring Let Us Worship to every single state capital across America. As I'm standing here in the U.S. Capitol, I am declaring today the breakthrough that we've seen here over 3 years of gathering for Let Us Worship. We are now going to bring to all 50 states. Beginning in 2023 and 2024, I am so proud to announce that Let Us Worship will be going to every single state capital capital across America. Just like we see Jesus tell the disciples to pray that thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we believe this is the season to bring the kingdom to the capitals across America. Join with us over the next 2 years as we journey to see the fires of revival burn in every single U.S. capital. This is a monumental and ambitious dream that God has given us, and we cannot do it without you. Now is the time. Let us worship.
Hey, everybody. Great to see you all. Thank you. Thank you. So all of you should have these on your seats. It's going to be the most amazing thing, December 17th, 18th, 19th, and 20th at the Phoenix Convention Center. That video did not do it justice at all. We have Tucker Carlson. We have Candace Owens. We have Kaylee McEnany. We have Pete Hegseth, because you're not going to hear enough of him, as well as Greg Gutfeld. We'll have the biggest speakers in the movement. And we'll see if there's some other big guests, and you can guess who they might be. If you live in Arizona and you're here tonight, I want to highly encourage you guys get a discount with this here tonight, or the QR code, amfest.com. It's 4 days. It's the biggest event in the entire movement here in Arizona, and we'd love to have all of you come and attend. And so there's also the QR code there. So it's a special discount for all of you guys here as part of our Freedom Night family. So if you have any questions about that, we have booths outside, and especially bring your son, your daughter, your grandkid. We're anticipating well over 10 to 12,000 people there this year, which is just amazing. And so get your tickets early. It's going to be extraordinary. You guys can follow this, and we want to have the biggest presence that we can have in Arizona. So who's ready to go vote? Good. Who actually is planning to vote on Election Day? Raise your hand. It's a lot of people. Good for you. Look, I'm not going to tell you how to vote tonight. That's not what tonight is about. But I'm going to tell you that you are biblically commanded to care about your nation and to vote. And we need every single person here tonight to make a commitment to not just go and vote, but to get 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 other people out to vote on Tuesday. Whatever your leanings are, I have a suspicion I know where your leanings are tonight. But there is a misconception, there is a lie out there that somehow Christians shouldn't care, that for some reason Christians should just kind of, oh, I don't care who's in charge and I don't care who's making decisions. As we say frequently here tonight at Freedom Night, Jeremiah 29:7, demand the welfare of the nation that you are in, because your welfare is tied to your nation's welfare. And I just want to encourage all of you to rise up like never before. It's right in front of you. It's very, very important. I know personally, I'm not trusting just putting my ballot in the mail. So I'm going to go in person and make sure that happens. And it really is just a couple hours away, everybody. It's incredibly important. So a couple other kind of thoughts on that. I know we're going to have some question and answer here tonight, but I just want to let all of you know, I travel the country, as you know, I visit college campuses, so you don't have to. There's something happening in this country that the media is not picking up on, but I think that in a couple days you're going to see it materialize in a very significant and serious way. But here's what has to happen. Regardless of your own political leanings or your own kind of, you know, wishes coming this Tuesday, the most important thing is this, is that in the next 5 or 6 days, you have to understand that it's not enough to be a spectator, you have to be a participant. And by the way, this is a nonpartisan thing to say. If you are not yet signed up to be an election judge, I highly recommend you look into that so that we have fair and free elections coming this Tuesday. There are a lot of open election judge positions still. Maricopa, I think, has all of them filled except for a couple areas. You might, if you don't know what election judge is, it's just an election observer, someone that's making sure the process unfolds. And I hate to break it to you, it's probably going to take a couple days to find out whoever wins whatever race here in Tuesday. And so look, regardless of all the different political leanings here, here's what we can say, is that it is your biblical commandment to vote, and then vote biblically. Vote for the person that is most in alignment with your values and your worldview, and get other people to do the same. Do not wake up the next day and wish you would have cast a ballot and said, oh, well, I don't like that person, I don't like that, I don't like those decisions. You have a great opportunity to do that. And so tonight we have an amazing opportunity to dive deep into one of the issues that so many of you people care about, that so many of us care about. And by the way, our guest visited and saw firsthand Dream City Christian at Turning Point Academy, and I got to tell you, Pete was blown away, and I was blown away. And by the way, how awesome was that performance that we just saw? That was really special, I got to tell you. That was really amazing. And really, the battle that goes beyond politics, the battle that is shaping our country, is the battle happening in the classroom. What is happening in high school classrooms, elementary classrooms, what's happening in our schools, what's happening in our colleges, is the most important war. You could call it a culture war that's unfolding. I know so many of you have really seen in the last couple years new energy and new commitment around these ideas, where all of a sudden you see pornography in our local school boards, in our local school districts, in our textbooks. You see these radical ideas start to pop up in ways you never would have imagined. And there is a parents' movement, by the way, in this country that is strong and is getting bigger by the day in a very significant way. But I was really moved by this book, Battle for the American Mind, by Pete Hegseth. And I read a lot of books, and I have to say about 50% of the books I read, I just stop because it's just kind of the usual popcorn, you know what I mean? It's the same thing. And, you know, Pete sent a copy of this to me, and he heavily promoted it on Fox and did a great job of it. And I started reading it, and I started to say out loud, that's a good point. I didn't know that. So Erica walks in from the other room. She said, what are you reading? And I said, this is Pete's new book. This is really well researched. And by the way, this is kind of the topic that I know a lot about. You know, this, it's kind of, we're in 10 years of this, going to college campuses, a lot dealing with homeschooling. And I learned a lot when I started to realize how deep the progressives were into our educational system, how serious this threat actually is, and then what the solution actually is. So I have to give this plug every single time. If you have a young person in your life and you're kind of school shopping, send them the Dream City Christian at Turning Point Academy, because that's part of the solution that we're going to talk about tonight. But honestly, we're very focused on the election. Great. But on the people that are actually going to control the country or not control the country, it's actually more important what's happening in the classroom than even the ballot box right now. It's actually a lot more important of what values are you passing down? How do you view the world? Do you believe there is a God? Do you believe, you know, America is a good country? That's the most important thing in front of us. And Pete did an amazing job researching this book. It was a bestseller all across the board. And I look forward to exploring it, not just talking about the problem, but also the solution. Because we in Arizona, we need to be on the front edge of, we already have great school choice legislation, thankfully, but starting new micro schools, hybrid schools, supporting Dream City Christian and Turning Point Academy, sending your kids there, and understanding the threat that every single kid in government schools right now in the state of Arizona is likely being propagandized by this progressive venom. And we have a duty as Christians to care about that and go about solving it. So join me in welcoming Fox and Friends host Pete Hegseth to the stage.
How you doing?
Thank you, Charlie.
Pete, great to see you, man. Thank you. And I know you'll be at America Fest.
Yes.
And it's going to be a lot of fun. You've been there, you were there last year and been to our other events. Pete, tell us about the book, Battle for the American Mind.
I will. First of all, I'm so encouraged by all of you. Thank you for spending your Wednesday night with me. There's so many things you could be doing. I'm encouraged by what this church is doing, not just in reaching people for Christ, but engaging boldly in the culture, which is exactly what we need churches to do. And then a partnership with a school. The reason we were at Dream City Christian is because at Fox Nation, I host a series called The Miseducation of America, which is a five-part series. We're doing season two. Season two is about gender studies and the sexualization of our kids, as well as the grip that our teachers' unions have on the government schools in our country. But then we realized we've been doing a lot of problem identification. Let's talk about the solution. We want to highlight schools like Dream City and the partnership with churches, which used to be the standard. And many churches abandoned that mission, and in the void came progressives with a whole different prerogative. So that's the baseline of Battle for the American Mind. And the first chapter is called The 16,000-Hour War, because there are 16,000 hours your kids spend in school between kindergarten and their senior year, the most precious years of their life. And the story of the progressive takeover of K through 12 education, because that's what it is. When you read the book, the first step to recovery is understanding the depth of your problem, right? You have to understand the firm and complete grip the progressives and modern leftists have on education today, almost across the board. It doesn't matter what zip code you're in. The first key is understanding not what they put into the school, not the indoctrination, because there's plenty of that. You can see it on Fox, or well, pretty much only Fox, these days. It's what they removed. The secret of the story is not what they put in. The secret of the story is what they removed. It was very, very intentional. It was a plot. They talked about it openly. We had to rediscover it. And I think you know the answer. The first thing they knew they had to remove from the classroom was God. And they targeted it because our country assumed that would always be part of the classroom. You go back 120 years, there was a cross and a Bible in every single school in America. Public schools, a cross and a Bible. It was part of the way our kids were raised and educated. And then progressives, and this is different than the progressives we see today, Charlie. This was a whole movement run by socialists and atheists. When you meet the characters in this book, almost to a man and to a woman, they are socialists, atheists, and later on Marxists, who loathed the Judeo-Christian values of our republic and sought their destruction. And they realized that the classroom was the place to do it. And a word we talk about, you'll be introduced to early in the book, is an ancient Greek word called paideia. There's no direct translation for it in English. And I got to give a lot of credit to my co-author on the book, David Goodwin, as well. He runs the Association of Classical Christian Schools. So while we'll talk about the problem, I'm actually more optimistic about education in America today than I've ever been, and I'll tell you why. But this word paideia, which probably none of us grew up learning because we didn't learn Latin and Greek like they used to understand and engage with ancient texts and biblical wisdom, paideia is how we educate our youngest. It's the enculturation, it's the vision of the good life that we imprint on the souls of our youngest kids. And what progressives realized is if you can capture kids effectively before the age of 13 and change their paideia, their view of the world, then everything else down the pipeline is much, much easier. That's why they don't want us. College is a scam, as Charlie wrote about. It is, but they were never set to end there. That was where they started. Their goal has always been not to stop at colleges and universities, but burrow into our high schools, middle schools, and now you see evident before our eyes our elementary schools. Because if you teach kids there is no such thing as biological sex, that it's just a fluid spectrum of gender, or you teach kids that because of their skin color, they must be inherently oppressor or oppressed, a victim or an oppressor. If this is a teacher with authority in front of a fourth grader, and that fourth grader comes home believing what that teacher is teaching and reinforced by all the curriculum and pedagogy that goes with it, you've now changed the entire way in which they view the world, which means introducing them to biblical truth later on becomes that much more difficult. That's what the progressives targeted, and the story over 100 years has been hidden, and we tried to expose it.
Yeah, and I think people are just waking up to this. So this has been 100 years in the making, is what you talk about in the book. How were the founding fathers educated?
Don't you think every single kid in America today deserves the type of education that brought the brilliance of 1776? And it wasn't complicated. This was a 2,000-year lineage of Western civilization, of Judeo-Christian values, the marriage of Athens and Jerusalem, of faith and reason, that was the great books, that was biblical wisdom, that was Latin, it was Greek, it was theology, it was philosophy, it was actual history. It was those ingredients that they grappled with, that they debated about, that brought about that brilliance of the greatest human experiment we've ever seen on the planet. It was not an accident. Churches had a great deal to do with it. Who were many of the leaders of our revolution? Ministers and reverends. Who is the top? I'm not trying to get into a tangent here. Do you know who the top, reverend, I guess, at Harvard University is today? He's an atheist.
That's true.
He's an atheist. We're so far gone from what our founders actually engaged with that they would not recognize it at all today. It was a classical Christian education. It was the way, and none of it was, it wasn't perfect, but they understood that teaching people to think critically created free-thinking people who couldn't be captured by demagoguery. And when you can think critically and think freely, whether you're a mason or a blacksmith or a farmer, do you think people in the 1780s or 90s had more use for a classical education than we do today? Absolutely not. It was a baseline. And what progressives understood is, no, we want to take thinkers and turn them into workers. And through creating thinkers and turning them into workers, the first thing we need to remove is all of that highfalutin thinking stuff. And turn it into vocational training.
Yeah.
And God was the first thing they removed in that process.
And so in the late 1800s, here's the Industrial Revolution. And you have a lot of thinkers start to introduce this idea that because of technology, everything the founding fathers wrote can be disregarded. Now, this is a very simple way to describe it. Oh, we have Twitter and airplanes. We don't need the Declaration or the Constitution anymore. Now, by the way, a lot of people on college campuses believe that. We've progressed so far, therefore we don't need that old stuff. Woodrow Wilson said this, by the way. Woodrow Wilson was the first American president. He was a progressive. He was a friend with all these people. He was a college president at Princeton University, governor of New Jersey, became president in 1912. And he argued that basically the founding fathers, they were fine at the time, but they don't know how advanced we are. Now, that right there is a non-biblical view of humanity. Because we believe just because times progress, human beings don't. We believe human beings' brokenness is a standard that does not change. In fact, we believe technology only makes it easier for us to screw up. We believe technology only makes it easier for us to be awful and to be murderous and to be greedy. In fact, it's the human being that you should focus on trying to create good people. So the founding fathers created the Constitution. It wasn't written for the times, written to stand the test of time, right? Because it is a document that mulls and dwells over eternal truths, not just things that are temporary. So enter all these thinkers in the late 1800s where they see the steam engine. They see all of this advancement. And with it, Darwin's theory of evolution, all these other kind of more, let's say, provocative thinkers, Friedrich Nietzsche, Hegel, that are really kind of pushing ancient knowledge by the wayside. And then they say, hey, we have to change the way we educate. And the way they did it is what, Pete? They basically said, enough of this Socratic way of learning, enough of this traditional way of having the church or the parent. We need to what? Have structured school, very specific times, everyone sitting and looking at the teacher in rows. By the way that most kids in government schools sit in the classroom is something that's only 100 years old. And by the way, Dream City Christian at Turning Point Academy, when we went into the classroom there, they weren't sitting that way. They were also looking collaboratively in their own little working groups. Just the way that you sit in a class, single file, is awful. There is no evidence actually kids learn that way well. In fact, there's evidence that they actually learn terribly that way. But if you're trying to create worker bees in a factory, that's a good way. Elaborate on all that, Pete.
Absolutely right. Progressives had social control on the mind. And Charlie, you're exactly right. It all comes back to the garden. It all comes back to the original sin. It all comes back to whether or not you believe men and women are perfectible. So progressives rejected the idea of original sin, that we are all sinners in need of God's grace, and said through education and social control, we can create generations of future reliable voters who will perpetuate our utopian schemes. See, they didn't know exactly where it would lead. It wasn't a conspiracy, but they knew exactly where it wouldn't lead. It wouldn't lead toward Judeo-Christian values and biblical wisdom. They knew that. That's where we'll get into critical theory if we want to, and the whole idea of where that's a whole nother topic. But I got a progressive education, and so did you, almost to a man and to a woman. And I went to a public school in the 1990s in conservative suburban Minnesota. My parents were Christians, my dad was an educator, my mom was a stay-at-home mom. We went to a wonderful church that reminds me a lot of this church. And I went to church on Sunday, and we went to Awana and Wednesday night church on Wednesday nights. And I had a wonderful upbringing. But everything about the confines of my classroom was created by progressives 100 years ago. You mentioned the rose. You mentioned that approach. The bell ringing. God being removed, of course.
Lunch breaks.
Lunch breaks, different subjects. Social studies. The idea we're not going to study civics, history, philosophy, theology. We're going to create psychology and social studies and split it all up as if we can dissect human nature and through a scientific method, which they've invented.
That's right.
Create more perfectible human beings by controlling how they think and what they think. All created by progressives. So almost every subject and frame. Did you take social studies? I took social studies. The progressives made it up. It's a made up conglomerate of subjects meant to silo the way that we think, as opposed to basing all of wisdom in God's wisdom, in his word. And it all makes sense looking at it through that lens. See, you see, John Dewey, who's the father of modern progressive education, founded a school in Gary, Indiana called the Gary Plan. And they knew the parents there would revolt in the early 20th century if they took God out. So they decided, we'll just have a pullout period. So the kids can still get religious instruction, they just have to leave the campus. And then when they come back, we'll continue with the secular education. Well, they debated this in the New Republic, the progressive magazine of the time. Then they moved the school in another variation to New York City, where they continued it and got more aggressive about how to remove God. John Dewey then eventually lands at Columbia University. The story goes on, and the way in which they burrowed into the institutions to change the way in which we learn. Here's one lesson they took in particular. Frances Willard, probably never heard her name, and I hadn't before this project either. She was a suffragette, but also fought for prohibition in the 1870s, 1890s, a socialist. She realized that if you put curriculum in third grade classrooms across America, and this was her mission, anti-alcohol curriculum, that she thought, let's see what happens. What happened 40 years later? The 18th Amendment, a constitutional amendment banning the sale and consumption of alcohol across America. It succeeded beyond her wildest dreams. And the progressives studied this movement and said, if we can control second, third, and fourth grade curriculum, imagine the political effect we can have in the future.
Imagine right now where they're teaching environmentalism and climate change alarmism and racial justice. What does that look like politically 30 years from now? Right? That is the horizon. And yes, what is happening 5 days from now in Arizona, you better believe it's important, right? But what about what's going to happen 10 years and 15 and 20 and 25 years and 30 years? That battle in the classroom is the most consequential. Pete, do you have a thought on that?
It's uncharted territory, actually. This gives me hope. What Turning Point is doing, giving me hope. What homeschoolers and classical Christian schools across America are doing, give me hope. So none of this is irreversible. Yeah. But if you look at the trajectory, we had a Western Christian paideia for about 40 years from the 1920s to the 1960s. And then we had effectively American progressive paideia, and I'll explain that for a second, from the 60s to the early 2000s. We are living in basically a culturally Marxist paideia at this point.
Yes, that's right.
When you look at the stranglehold that they have on K through 12, from the unions to the teachers' colleges to the accreditors to the testing to the state standards to the federal standards to the funding, it is all a certain set of prerogatives, none of which reflect the values of this church or of your family. And that's intentional. And when I say American progressive paideia, what did they replace the Bible and the cross with? They replaced it with a flag and a pledge. The early progressives replaced God with allegiance to the state. Now, I love the Pledge of Allegiance, and I revere our flag, fought for it. And so it has nothing, but the progressives saw it as a gradual step. What do they care today about the pledge and the flag? They're happy to get rid of it now. It was always a step for social control and allegiance to the state. The original Pledge of Allegiance in America, written by Francis Bellamy in the 1890s, he's a socialist, and it did not include under God. So the original Pledge of Allegiance did not include under God. Eisenhower added that in the 1950s when we were fighting the godless communists. They wanted, instead of kids reading Bibles and reciting prayers, they wanted kids saying a secular pledge and uniting around a flag, because that's a lot easier, a lot more malleable than biblical wisdom and biblical truth, which does not change.
And then they removed prayer in schools in one of the worst Supreme Court decisions in American history. And by the way, the prayer that was in schools was a theistic prayer. It was not Christian. It basically said, to the God of above, we pray, we thank you for today, and we pray for my classmates and my country. It was very simple. And I truly believe as soon as we removed prayer from schools, that was one of the worst decisions that has happened in modern America. I really believe that in more ways than one. And so, Pete, something I want to talk about, though, is so we kind of live through the aftermath and the after effects of this. And people are catching up at a rapid pace. More people are interested and send us emails on our podcast asking about critical race theory, critical theory, postmodernism. And it comes down to all of those are kind of the after effects of losing the education war or not engaging in it enough. But I actually think we're catching up rather significantly and in a very promising way. I mean, I just look around the audience here. I see people that I know are challenging the Scottsdale Unified School Board in amazing ways. I see people running for school board. I see moms here that are in the front. I'm not going to say any names, but I see some people that are doing some really significant things. I mean, just from all the local projects we have going here. So we're starting to see a catch-up period. American homeschooling has doubled over the last year and a half. We're seeing an incredible demand in this way. And so, but Pete, you mentioned something interesting, which is you said, well, it's not a conspiracy. I agree. However, there was a collective agreement.
Absolutely.
That they wanted to have a less free, non-constitutional country because of their takeover of education. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely. And they did it all under the guise of democracy.
Yes. My least favorite word, by the way. My reporters love it when I say this, when I say democracy is a bad idea. By the way, we don't have a democracy. We live in a constitutional republic. We've never had a democracy, okay? And people go nuts when I say that. Let me just expand. And you could comment on it.
Our founders dismissed democracy.
No, they wrote they against them. It as mob rule and as the tyranny of the cities against the farms, against the agrarian. A constitutional republic has consent to the governed, independent judiciary, separation of powers, checks and balances. A democracy is like Brazil. If you get one more vote than the other person, you could do whatever you want. That's a very bad way to run a country. Sorry, Pete, I had to rant against democracy.
You're exactly right. The reason I said I'm so optimistic is because of all the things you said. We called it the COVID-16-19 moment, what happened a couple of years ago in the book. When all of us were at home, kids and grandkids, through a Zoom screen, and you were aghast at what you were seeing, and that was right when the 1619 Project came out, and they said 1776 is racist, and the real founding date is 1619, and oh, by the way, pick your gender pronoun. Parents revolted, but a lot of them looked around and said, how did this happen? And they looked for alternatives. And we are in a renaissance of education in America today. Let me say something very clearly and honestly with all of you. We're all friends now. If you can, today, get your kids out of government schools. Right now.
And Pete, that's a big lift for some parents, though. And by the way, he's not saying it in a scolding way. He's just encouraging. Elaborate.
I'm saying this as someone who went to public school, whose parents, my dad was a public school teacher, and had kids in public school at one point. I'm not an anti-public school person. I'm a pro-education, real education for kids. The teachers unions, take them for example. By the way, they used to be Christian conservative teachers associations that would pass out biblical tracts before they were taken over by radical unions in the 40s and 50s and 60s and turned into effectively a political entity for the Democrat Party. They created the Department of Education after they elected Jimmy Carter. So the Federal Department of Education, which has been growing in size and scope, is now controlled by teachers unions who have only one political persuasion and are controlled by the radical left, who control who becomes a teacher and what goes into your classroom and what they're allowed to teach. So as there are wonderful, God-fearing, Christian, patriot, public school teachers in this audience, I'm sure, and I salute you for what you do every day. And I salute the parents that are at school board meetings fighting.
And there's several in this audience that are fighting like none other.
And I love it. I love it, love it, love it. But my mom did the same thing in the 1990s. A new self-esteem curriculum called a values-free curriculum.
Worst.
I'm sure benign by today's standards. And what happened? She pulled me out, got a few parents riled up. And what changed in Forest Lake Independent School District? Nothing. So, and I write about it in the book as well. I feel like protesting at school boards today, for the most part, is like charging a fortified machine gun nest with a Nerf gun. I salute your efforts, but you're probably going to die because it only fortifies their position and their belief in their own power and strength and lack of accountability in that position. So I recognize there are a lot of people that can't leave their current educational situation. And in that case, fight. Fight with all your might for your kids and give them every single opportunity in your home that's gonna be a full-time job unwinding the indoctrination that they're facing at school. And I know my 12-year-old is not capable of being salt and light right now.
Not yet.
My 6-year-old still thinks he has a legitimate shot at being Batman. Okay? They're not ready to take on the culture wars. I want to fortify them before I ask them and prepare them to be salt and light in the world. So what we argue for in the book is a radical reorientation of your life around the education of your kids. I know what you want to do at home as parents and grandparents. I know what you want to do at church by introducing your kids and grandkids to our Lord and Savior. But then are you outsourcing 8 hours a day and 40 hours a week and 16,000 hours over the course of their life to someone else who's teaching them things that are completely against? That's what we've awoken up to. And if you need to take a second job or drive 20 minutes further or give up a vacation or take out a second mortgage or refinance, maybe not right now. Find what you can do, because preparing them now, this is the moment you can prepare them. And that legacy is, because I love my parents, but what I know I had was a secular core with a Christian veneer, and I didn't even know it. And I wasn't prepared for the world I was entering into, and I can't imagine what kids confront today.
And when I come across a kid who's classically educated, it is a night and day difference between a kid that is progressively educated versus classically educated. They dwell on the topics of what is a human being, what is the soul, is there a God, what is beautiful, what is worthy of wonder, what is good, what is true. Most kids that are progressively educated, even the kids that are conservative, they haven't thought deeply about any of that. It's just about survival and kind of fighting back against all this nonsense. And as you all know, without a vision, the people perish, as it says in Proverbs. What is the vision? Well, in year 2045, if we keep up this momentum, if this trajectory continues, the front page of the New York Times will say, sudden right shift in America attributable to parents' movement post-COVID, where homeschooling doubled. That's the vision in 25 years from now.
Yes.
Is where they're all of a sudden going to say, this country isn't as liberal as we thought it would be. All the National Education Association, the American Federation of Teachers, it can happen. But it takes many years and decades of work. So Pete, I want to also ask you about, I want you to describe more about classical education and kind of the promise of that, especially for people that want to dive into it and just how successful it really has been and can continue to be.
We dedicated the book to families who resurrected classical Christian education about 40 years ago. I think the darkest moment of education in America was the 1970s. Homeschooling was under assault. They were trying to make it illegal in many states. They'd already gone after parochial school in multiple states. And there were zero classical Christian schools in America. Maybe there were people homeschooling and teaching it, but brick and mortars, there were zero. And when you talk to people that refounded that movement, it's like archaeology. Because all of us got a progressive education, almost all of us. And so relearning how to learn requires archaeology to rediscover how we used to teach kids how to think freely, how to engage with original sources and original texts, how to interweave biblical truth into all subjects. So you discover wonder and you discover beauty and you search for truth and you ask the big questions. What is my relationship to God? Where do my rights actually come from, government or God? How do I engage with my founding documents? The big question, and by the way, the criticism I get all the time is that you're whitewashing history, you're putting your kids in a bubble. Walk into a classical Christian school or a classic school, the last thing you will see is a bubble. In fact, we went into one to film, and they were talking about modern feminism and the argument of modern feminism. And it was a very robust debate, all based on biblical wisdom and historical texts about human nature. It was fascinating to watch men and women, 16, 17-year-olds, engaging constructively in this conversation, preparing them for the conversations in the future. So when you walk into a classical school, the first thing you will say is, can I please go back to school? Because you will realize what you did not, you were never engaged with, and therefore, never taught. I see that with my 12-year-olds right now, what they're engaging with. I went to a couple of terrible Ivy League schools where I never engaged with any of those topics because all those big falutin types had already gotten rid of all of that before I got there, so I didn't even know what I was missing. By the way, you can go to classicalchristian.org. I bet you'll find more schools than you're even aware of in the Phoenix area and throughout Arizona. Classical Conversations is a homeschool hybrid model.
They're great.
They're amazing. There's over 100,000, tens of thousands of students who do hybrid homeschooling through Classical Conversations, where you do a couple of days at home and a couple of days with other families. So there's a lot of support and a lot of encouragement. That's been growing like gangbusters. So the movement is getting rid of a lot of the excuses that we've all had.
Yes.
And especially in Arizona, where in more cases than not, the dollars will follow.
Well, the tax incentives here are amazing. It's the best in the country, by the way. And so the excuse financially is you really don't have much of an excuse if you live in Arizona, I'll be honest. Now, the only excuse you might have is waiting lists. Great Hearts has a huge waiting list. They're thinking of building a Hillsdale Barney charter here, and Hillsdale has one that's still in motion. I know a lot of parents are trying to do that. And so, obviously, Dream City Christian, Turning Point Academy, this is growing like crazy. And so, but more is more. That's the thing where someone says, oh, Charlie, are you competing? I said, no. I said, my competition isn't Hillsdale or Great Hearts. My competition is Scottsdale Unified School District. That's my competition. Are you kidding me? Or Chandler Unified School District, where they're doing critical race theory, and they're saying that men can become pregnant, and they have pornography in the schools in the West Valley, which is all over Arizona, by the way, all over. And that has to be a huge priority of the next legislative session, by the way, to get rid of this venom in our schools. And so, Pete, I want to get to some questions here, but I want to close with, what is the call for Christians in particular? Because, you know, you speak a lot of different places and you talk about classical education and secular education and the downsides of it. But for Christians that are here, us being in a church, it really should be a no-brainer in some ways, right? This is a call for the church to open up their resources, their facilities. This is the rallying cry of the American church, right?
It is. This movement starts and survives and only thrives if churches lead it. Almost every church I've ever gone to, and I've moved a lot, so I've been to many, almost completely ignores the topic of education. Won't even talk about it, because it's really tough to talk about. What do you want to do, offend 80% of your parishioners, almost all of which go to public school, and tell them what they're giving their kids is not good enough? That's not what I'm telling you. I'm not imputing your motives or your intentions or your love for your kids. Most of us, until about 2 years ago, or 3 years ago when we started doing our research, or 5 years ago, had no idea that the Marxists had embedded critical theory in New York City and Columbia University in the 1930s and 40s, and it made its way throughout our teachers' colleges across the country. And then fast forward 50 years, up pops critical race theory, and we're all saying, what is this? And the progressives have been talking about it for 60 years, and it's been in our teachers' colleges for 40, and Howard Zinn, right, has written the most powerful textbook, most best-selling textbook in the last 40 years in American history, and it's American history written from the Soviet perspective. Your kids likely got most of their history either directly from a people's history of the United States,
yes, that's
or embedded into their textbooks written by Howard Zinn, an avowed anti-American Marxist.
Millions of kids right now are getting that education in America.
Right now, in public schools, in Tennessee, where I'm from.
Here in Arizona.
And here in Arizona, in North Dakota, Minnesota, Oregon, to Massachusetts, and every other red state in between. Because the education department and teachers' unions have centralized control of what's acceptable into textbooks and into curriculum. So we're all in the same place. We're all learning this in real time. And that's why I say radical reorientation, but that's not just on parents. That is on Christian leaders and pastors to do what Dream City is doing, which is speak boldly and truthfully to all Christian families.
And this is what's so great about Dream City. And by the way, we can start lining up for questions too, please, guys. Is one of the things I love is the pastor needs to at least educate their church about the problem and to explain it, right? I mean, churches, they have all sorts of different ministries, homeless ministries, drug recovery ministries, men's ministries. Why don't they have one dedicated to education, right? I mean, and that's what Dream City has done, whether, you know, through the school or through assistance. This is the pressing, civilizational, defining issue right now in more ways than one. Quick thought, Pete, and then we'll get to some questions.
Quick thought. I can't remember which socialist atheist said this in the book, but
I'll try to help.
You help me out. This is a direct quote. What hope do the theists have with their church on Sunday and Wednesday night up against 40 hours a week of secular education? They don't have a chance. It's not enough to try to undo it at the dinner table or have a few discussions or take them to church and take them to Sunday. By the way, you know where Sunday school came from? It came because churches abdicated Monday through Friday school, outsourced it to government schools, and decided we're just going to do school on Sunday. It's not the way it used to be, and we need to return to that.
It is said that the Constitution was written solely for a moral and religious people. It is wholly inadequate for the people of any other. If you want this republic to continue, not a democracy, our republic to continue, you must have a moral and religious people. Or at the very least, moral and virtuous. That is not going to happen in secular progressive education through the government schools. Okay, we'll get a question here. Let's try to have the questions focused on education if we can. Yeah.
Thank you so much. I have spent my adult lifetime as a dedicated university professor. I won't mention the university.
Okay.
But this month, I will finally step away from my job, not in small part because of woke culture.
Wow. God bless you. Wow.
As life and God would have it, I have been invited to help out at a small charter school with values that align with mine. My question is, what advice would you give me to help keep politics out and keep values in?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm not totally in agreement to keep politics out because, I mean, Aristotle wrote about politics. I hear what you're saying, though. Don't make it political. But the idea of talking about political systems and structures, I think, is great. But it shouldn't be partisan. I think that's what you're getting at, right? And it should be value-driven and around philosophy. First, I just want to commend you because we need more people to get into... I don't know where you're a professor. I don't know any of that. But I actually think you're going to make a bigger impact with high school kids and middle school kids than even with college kids. I'll be honest, that your talent is going to be, you know, really, really needed. Look, my advice is this, is use the Socratic method. It's worked. The classical form of education is not about you know, the self-esteem movement, which I could do a whole speech on the self-esteem movement. I got to do a tangent on that in a second. It's just total nonsense. These government schools do so much damage to these kids. You wonder why they're killing themselves. It's because of the self-esteem movement, partially. I'll tell you why in a second. But it's also about challenging them that the work is worth it to be able to understand what is beautiful, good, and true. And so what college does, or secular education does, is they try to make you think like a factory worker. What classical education does, properly understood, or the charter school hopefully you're going to, is that, no, you're a human being with a soul, and you must try to develop your reason and those skills to be able to understand the things that are eternal, not temporal. That's what a proper teacher does, not just says, hey, here's a bunch of skills. And that's fine, there's a place for that, but honestly, you can always add skills on, but it's very hard once someone has no basis whatsoever to then be able to convince them that there is something that is true. I'll give you an example. I was just at University of Texas, Austin. These kids are incredibly high IQ test scores, the least wise group of people I've ever been around. Why? The Bible tells us, wisdom begins with the fear of the Lord. These universities have no God, so there's no wisdom. Of course that they're saying things. They say men can become pregnant. There's unlimited genders. They say all this nonsense. That's where you have to start. Pete, your thoughts.
You're so right. Even what we call our schools, they used to be called grammar, logic, and rhetoric schools. It was replaced by elementary, and that was all, it was all part of remaking. I would just salute you for your courage. Most people can't stop a career track and say, I don't support what's being done in my name in part, and I'm going to go make a change. Speak as boldly as you can about that to as many people as you can who are former colleagues or others, and motivate them to recognize that that same sort of choice is possible. The kind of value you're going to add to those young kids' life is immense, and I appreciate you.
We'll go over here.
God bless both of you. My granddaughter is 10, and she's in the Oak Creek Cottonwood School District, and her teacher identifies as MX. So, and she signs her papers as her and she, and she is allowed to watch, they're made to watch in her class 15 minutes a day of CNN 10. So my radar went up when she asked me what CNN was, if it was good. And I said, well, how do you know? She says, well, I don't know. But it just doesn't seem right. I said, so what do you do when you have to write a report for 15 minutes of this watching CNN 10? She says, well, I don't really pay attention because I asked my teacher if I had to write. And she said, yes, I did. So I just copy my friends. But I watch Newsmax all the time at Dad's house. So I get a lot, but I just don't think it's right to be watching CNN. So now, somebody's doing the right thing, right? Because her radar went up. But what can I do because it's not, I don't want to sound like a chicken, but what can I do to change things in her school without switching schools? Because that doesn't seem to be an option right now.
A very difficult dilemma. I will shoot straight with you. I don't think there's a lot if you walk in to talk to the principal or the superintendent or the teacher that you're going to get. Here's what you're going to get. Right here. Shutdown mode, default to talking points. Anything you would say that's outside the perimeters of the box will be deemed as discriminatory or not diverse enough and not tolerant enough. That is what, those are the words they use to try to put you in a box. Now, you as a grandmother, parents, obviously are going to do everything you can on the outside. But think about that. 10 years old, why are we watching CNN, MX? I don't even know what that means. They certainly don't. But it becomes the water in which they swim. It becomes the environment that is the default norm. You can't write a paper without giving in to the orthodoxy of whatever the teacher and the environment has created. So they may become conservative later on, but that's after speaking the language of progressives for 8 more years until they graduate, which that's a recipe for getting some survivors because you're politically attuned, but most parents and grandparents probably aren't as engaged, which means those kids are not surviving. So you're going to fight with all you have because you love that child. If you can get them out, I would get them out. I know that may not be an option, and I understand that. So it's going to mean you're going to have to be all over everything, because I'm not saying you shouldn't engage. You should. With teachers, make sure they know you're paying attention. Absolutely. Ask questions. But the likelihood that you're going to get some sort of a affirmative response is pretty low.
Yeah, I mean, and with the new Arizona bill, it's actually probably more financially attainable than I think people realize to take your kid out of public school right now. It's a pretty, if you guys are not educated on this bill that was just signed, it's now law. It's not perfect, but I mean, you're within almost a dollar for dollar match at some schools to have the money follow the kid to private and charter schools. It's really amazing. So thank you. We got to get to the next question. Thank you.
Hi guys, my name is Calissa and I attend GCU as a dual enrollment student. I am in Christian worldview class and my professor is clearly left-leaning. He has said things like Jesus wants us to judge as Christians. I also did a paper on the pro-life side of abortion, of which he failed me on. I was wondering how you think I should handle it and what I can do to combat his and other professors' biased behavior moving forward.
What school is that at? Sorry.
GCU.
At Grand Canyon? Yeah.
Grand Canyon University?
Yeah. Yeah. Remember when I went after Grand Canyon a couple months ago and everyone attacked me? Not you guys didn't, but I got so much hate mail from people. Can you just I had difficulty hearing you.
Did you say one of them is you failed? You got failed on our paper because it was pro-life?
Yeah.
And what was the other one?
He said that Jesus wants us to judge as Christians.
Okay. Jesus wants us to judge?
Jesus, yeah.
That's theologically interesting. I don't know. I have to bring it up with management about that.
Is GCU a Christian university?
Allegedly.
Oh, okay. I don't. I'm sorry. I'm not. I've heard of it.
To be fair. We had an amazing event there. Our chapter did a great job, and they did. They did treat us well from the administration. I have to be fair. But what's happening is in the classroom. What you're just telling me is a horror show. So.
You know what? It's just, I'll use a military analogy. The military academies used to almost all be run by former officers of the Army or Navy. As more and more of the faculty became civilian teachers, all the junk that came out of teachers' colleges and out of other universities has made its way into military academies. I think a lot of the same thing has happened at a lot of Christian universities, which were dedicated to biblical wisdom, until they bought into the educational system that creates the same teachers that go to secular colleges. And then they bring those very same ideas into those universities, which slowly over time, if they're not intentional about their culture, you lose Christian universities. We see it all the time. Just stand up and be bold. Find other Christians, Turning Point Chapter. I tell you, when I go to America Fest and Student Action Summit.
And we have some of our GCU kids somewhere.
I bet. Back there. There we go. Yeah. They're back there. It almost feels like at first, Charlie, a giant student therapy session, because it was students looking around saying there are other people like me that, right. There is strength in numbers, and keep standing up.
I just want to encourage you. It takes courage to say, I'm going to say something I know that will make me be graded down or differently. You just got to decide at that point. And then I would not be shy about appealing that up the hierarchy at GCU. I wouldn't be shy, because here's what I'll say. A lot of very generous, good people give a lot of money to GCU because they present themselves as a conservative Christian school. So I don't think they would love to hear that, and I think you actually might get that remedied pretty quick.
First of all, I want to thank both of you for being a voice for us in the media.
Thank you.
You know, all this will be for nothing if we don't stop them from robbing our election. How are we going to do that? Keep them from robbing our election.
Love the energy. I want to say focus on education. But I'll talk personally for a second about this. Is that okay?
Sure.
And I agree with you, by the way, completely. And I just want to give a fair warning. This is Charlie Kirk speaking personally, not on behalf of Turning Point USA. You could laugh all you want, but I have people that watch everything I say. Are we good on the disclaimer, Pete? Okay, Charlie Kirk personally. Okay, a lot of you are planning to vote on Election Day. I think that's great. But but just be prepared for massive traffic jams, paper shortages, ink shortages, pipe bursts, okay? I am very encouraged, though, to just let you know that people are not just putting their ballot in the mail. If you vote in person on election day, that is the least amount of people that touch your ballot, and it will be counted second, which is better than ninth in the way that we do our Honduran election system here in Arizona, where it's we first count the mail-in ballots, and then we count the in-person early, and then the same-day election, and then the people that then drop off their ballot that was mailed to them. It's so silly. It's an insult to all of our intelligence. We got to fix this, everybody. I am so tired of this, by the way. It is awful. It is it's a disgrace. But to answer your question, let me... Yes, we do. We have every one of those people, but I want us to say this. I'm so encouraged because all of us that are going to show up on election day are showing through our own action, we are going to do something differently to try to have a different result. And I think that's a great thing exhibited by all of us that are going to overwhelm the polls coming this Tuesday. My man.
Hi.
Yeah.
I just want to ask, in school, some people, they just don't want to flat out know about the Bible. They just, I try and tell them, and they just say no and walk away. What can I do to try and help and try and make it better?
Well, you've already got a bold spirit, and I love that. Keep learning. Keep learning, keep educating, keep praying. Keep focused on what you know to be good and right and true. And trust that that amazing institution that you go to will be reinforcing what you're saying. And whether they want to engage with God and the Bible or not, they're going to meet him somewhere in class. And I wish my kid would ask that question. That's all I can think.
And look, don't take it too personally. Most kids, they only care about sports and whatever. That's okay. Keep pushing. Be salt and light. Change the environment that you're in. It's totally normal. God bless you, man. Thank you. I know that sweatshirt.
Yeah. I got it at GCU when you came and spoke with us. Yeah. So I'm a senior also at GCU, and I'm going to be student teaching next year, hopefully at Dream City Christian, my favorite school. And I want to know, what are the top book titles that should be taught in every single classroom across America?
Wow, that's great. So obviously the Bible, we're doing that, and it needs to be the center of education, right? So I'm a big believer in classical education. So one of my big pieces of feedback to Protestant circles is Aquinas, who is a Catholic thinker, but honestly, it was before the Reformation, so there really shouldn't be any reason not to teach him. He is the best, most clearest author when it comes on proofs of God and getting a young person to believe in God reasonably and rationally. If you want a young person at a young age to understand and grasp that there is a God in the universe, Thomas Aquinas wrote a great book. It's hard to read, but you can get more digestible versions called the Summa Theologica. It's terrific. Once kids get older, this is why I love classical education. I think Aristotle is a really important thing for people to wrestle with, for Plato as well. But let's just kind of go to more modern, like post-1700s, okay? I know that's a joke, by the way, is that every young kid should learn the Federalist Papers. Every young kid should understand what Madison, Hamilton, and Jay really thought about when it came to the structure of our government. And then kind of coming into more modern times, kind of 1900s, 1950s, 1960s, I really truly believe that the ultimate red pill, and I say that in a very positive way, is Thomas Sowell should be taught in every American classroom. And I'm telling you, if you do not know who Thomas Sowell is, it will change your life. They want to racialize everything. His book, Discrimination and Disparities, is a life-changing book. The whole thesis is very simple. Just because there might be different outcomes between racial groups does not mean you can blame discrimination. It is the most simple argument, and it shatters all of the lies of the progressive left. And finally, kind of a passion of mine, kids need to be taught proper economics. Milton Friedman, Adam Smith. So those are things that are personal passion projects of mine. Pete?
I can't rattle off books like that. But I'll tell you, I remember when I read Bill Bennett, former education secretary, what's it called, the Last Best Hope, volume one, and there's multiple good books he's written, but he wrote a two-volume series on the history of America, and he wrote it in effect to, in part, to rebut Howard Zinn and what he had written had become so prolific. It's called The Last Best Hope, Volume 1 and Volume 2. It's basically the North American history through the United States. And I just remember going through, even through high school, and looking at my textbooks and saying, Mom, or you know, Dad, why is Ronald Reagan always the bad guy?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's so subtle. The progressives were these amazing good people who were forward thinkers, and the way they tinker on the margins. So find Christian patriotic historians, yes, and elevate their side of the story and equip kids with that. I mean, so there's a lot of great books out there. I mean, you can go to classicalchristian.org. They have a full laundry list of all the types of resources. But even on the more modern side, and the more original documents you can get,
that's
the better.
That's exactly right.
So the Declaration of Independence, you could do a whole graduate semester on that if you want to, but even just breaking it down for kids, because we dumb down really great, imaginative, powerful stories into these readers.
Oh, it's terrible.
Really boring for kids. So the more you can, original fables and great children's literature that Disney's dumbed down and everyone else is dumbed down, make that come alive. The more original, I think, the better.
And I'll add, anything by C.S. Lewis, I think he was the most important author of the 20th century, and every Christian should be. And by the way, not just his Christian apologetic stuff, That Hideous Strength and Abolition of Man. And this is a higher level, but if you want to get a high schooler to understand the tragedy of totalitarianism, have them read Brave New World by Aldous Huxley and obviously 1984 by George Orwell. George Orwell, just transparency, has a rather graphic sex scene, so if you have a kid read it, maybe just monitor that. I just never want to recommend. It is R-rated. Besides that, though, it is an unbelievable work. It is one of the most prophetic, articulate, and important pieces of literature ever, let alone in the last 100 years. We are living through basically every prediction of George Orwell, from the manipulation of speech, to surveillance, to the elimination of history, and all of that. Sorry, that was a very long two-parted answer.
Yep.
God bless you. We need more teachers. God bless you. We need more teachers. So important. All right, we'll do two more questions here and here. Sorry for everyone in line.
Peter Hegseth, Charlie Kirk, thank you, good and faithful servants, for sharing your gifts.
Thank you.
I have a couple quick sound bites leading to a question. I was educated K through 12 in Catholic school in Los Angeles, California. Peter, I guarantee to you that I didn't get the negative education that you talked about. Maybe some, and that maelstrom of organized history and teaching. In my school, 10 commandments, in the hallways, in the classrooms, U.S. Constitution, U.S. flag, each classroom for 8, K through 12, fortunate for me. A county in North Carolina, I better be careful to not name the county, I had a construction consulting assignment post-Hurricane Florence, 23 campuses.
Gotta get to the question, we're over time, so please.
23 campuses, U.S. Constitution, the Bill of Rights, the Our Father. My question is, combating a school board, what is something that can be said as a parent, a taxpaying parent in the neighborhood, in the community, that can shake these people to their core, other than saying, get behind these Satan?
Yeah. Yeah, so I'll just say, you need to FOIA them, it's Freedom of Information Act, and then overwhelm them at the meetings, right? And so it doesn't do everything. Again, I agree with Pete. You gotta get your kids out of government schools, I'll be honest. If you can, get them out of government schools, but it's not realistic for everybody, and I don't wanna say you're making a mistake to keep them in, but the ideal is to get them out. But FOIA requests, FOIA them to death, try to find out all the emails, all their backroom deals. And then, look, I'll be honest, you just got to keep showing up to the school boards. Pete, really quick, and then we'll get to the last question.
Yeah, I mean, part of the reason you're here is because you engaged with those ideas. K through 12 education has K kicked God out for the last 70 years, a couple of complaints to the school board, they're just going to look at you and say, wall of separation. That's what they do. They look at you and say, I've got stacks of emails from administrators saying wall of separation, which they'll say it's in the Constitution.
No, it's...
Of course it isn't. It's not in the Constitution. They believe it is. It's part of their dogma.
It's their mythology.
It's their mythology. And so there's not a whole lot you can say to a modern school board about God.
Last question. By the way, this is the last question of the year at Freedom Night, because we aren't doing a December one, because we have America Fest instead. And of course, Dream City does their Christmas pageant. So again, everyone register for America Fest. No pressure, last one of the year.
Hello, my name is Rebecca Jensen, and I'm in seventh grade, and I homeschool with Classical Conversations.
I know you. Hey, how are you? Classical is awesome. Yes.
I was wondering how I can get involved with TPUSA.
That's the best question of the whole year, I gotta
tell you. You planted that question. Rigged!
So we gotta start a Classical Conversations chapter. Our team would be involved. And by the way, I've spoke twice in the last year at Classical Conversations, and I gotta tell you, these kids are wicked smart. Just the difference between a classically educated kid, from how polite they are to how they communicate, to someone who's in the government schools, it's just like night and day difference. And so, but you gotta come to America Fest. You gotta get other friends involved to start a Turning Point USA chapter. And Pete?
One more commercial for Classical Conversations. A lot of people knock homeschooling and say, okay, it's not like the perception was 20, 30 years ago. We're talking sports teams, we're talking proms, we're talking a lot of the nostalgia that you have of what high school was, because of the power of the growth that it's had and the way that they work together with other homeschool families, you are not alone. Your kid is not alone. And they become part of a group of fellow Christians and classically trained young people who have a full-on high school experience.
We're gonna follow up and get a Turning Point chapter started immediately. God bless you, okay? So that's a perfect note to end on. What a year for Freedom Night, guys, right? I mean, all the programming we had, right? Massive community impact. We had Victor Marks this year. We had Bill Federer this year. We had Sean Foyt this year. We had amazing people, and you guys made it possible. You showed up, you supported us, you prayed for us, and we're going to continue it into the next year, as obviously we have a very busy month and a half going. So let me just thank Dream City for having this amazing year. And in 2023, we're going to be back on Wednesday with amazing people. We got Dennis Prager coming. We got amazing people coming in the new year. But let me just close with this, guys. Of course, register for America Fest. Tucker Carlson, Candace Owens, Kaylee McEnany, Greg Gutfeld, and more to come. Make sure you vote on Tuesday. But guess what? After that, the war is not over. We got to keep pushing forward. Stay involved with Turning Point USA. Stay involved in the local community. Stay involved in the education of your kids. And Pete, you did an amazing job with this book, truly. And Pete, thank you for being
with
us tonight.
Thank you guys very much. Thank you, Charles.
God bless you guys, and see you at America Fest. God bless you.